Welcome to Lingthusiasm, a podcast that's enthusiastic about linguistics. I'm Gretchen McCulloch, and I'm here with Kat Gupta. They're a linguist at the University of Roehampton, and we're getting enthusiastic about corpus linguistics. But first, some announcements. We're coming up to the anniversary month of Lingthusiasm. It's been 5 years since we started this podcast. Every year for our anniversary, we ask you to share Lingthusiasm with someone who could really enjoy listening to a linguistics podcast. And this really does help us grow. Most people still find podcasts through word of mouth. So if you know someone who likes language, who likes pop science, who likes podcasts with interesting facts, who likes podcasts with two hosts talking to each other, tell them about Lingthusiasm. If you share it on social media, we will be very happy to thank you if you tag us at Lingthusiasm. Or you can share one-on-one in a text message to one person and have a warm, fuzzy feeling in your heart that you've been helping out an independent linguistics podcast. If you've been with us for some of our journey, for all of our journey, we are really happy to have you on board. And as a reminder, we also have bonus episodes on Patreon. So this month's bonus episode is about linguistic illusions, when you hear one thing or maybe another, and your brain plays tricks on you when it comes to what you're hearing or seeing linguistically. We have this and 55 other bonus episodes, which are available at patreon.com/lingthusiasm if you want to help support the show financially. And we also have, this month is the end of our special offer where you can get a package of fun linguistics stickers sent to you in the mail. You can go to patreon.com/enthusiasm to get a special sticker pack and support the show by November 3rd, 2021. We really appreciate every kind of support you can have for the show, whether it's telling people about us, supporting us on Patreon, getting linguistics merch, or sharing with us your favorite moments from the show. Hello, Kat. Welcome to the show.
Hello, Gretchen. Thank you very much for having me on here.
So let's start with the question that we ask all of our guests. How did you get into linguistics?
So you can probably tell from my accent that I am from the UK and I was educated in the UK school system. So for our listeners who aren't in the UK, what this means is that you are able to leave school at 16, having taken a set of subjects and exams. But if you want to continue your education, you need to take a different set of exams or a different set of courses. And these are called AS levels, which are the 1 year course, and A levels, which are the full 2 year course.
Gotcha.
So these are much more focused than, say, in the US high school system. Most of our students coming to university have between probably 3 or 4 full A levels and maybe 1 or 2 AS levels. So it's a very restricted set of subjects. And it means that you have to make some quite hard decisions about what you go on to do. And when I was 16, I was absolutely convinced that I wanted to go into biology.
Okay.
And as you can see, this didn't happen.
And yet you're a linguist now. How did this come to be?
Exactly. So I took a set of A-levels that were very, very sciencey. So I was doing biology and chemistry and initially physics. And what I realized is that I didn't like this at all. And I wasn't very good at it either. But happily for me, what I was doing was English literature. Mm-hmm. And I was doing a weird, weird module called critical thinking. And the teacher of that and I got on quite well. And he was like, oh, I could probably teach you AS level philosophy.
Okay.
And the school was like, we don't offer this AS level. And he was like, surprise, now you do. So basically, the teaching of this module entailed sitting in the school quad, drinking really awful coffee and debating about whether God exists.
What more could you want from philosophy?
I mean, like, Plato and Socrates would be so proud of me. The first essay I wrote was in the exam itself.
Oh my God.
But to my shock, I did well enough that it seemed reasonable to continue this. Mm-hmm. So what I did is I found another sixth form college that were prepared to take me with my extremely messy academic history. And they were like, okay, what fits in your schedule? And one of the ones that did was English language. And I was like, okay, this sounds good. I quite enjoyed this. They called the teacher over. We had a nice chat. And she was like, yeah, I think you can do the full 2 year course in 1 year.
And so English language is kind of like linguistics?
Yes. So in the UK, we have a really, really weird system where linguistics seems to get called English language, certainly at GCSE, which is the pre-16 teaching I talked about, and at A-level.
Gotcha.
So then a lot of degrees end up calling their degrees English language and linguistics to fit into that.
So that people who have done English language know that that's where they should be going.
Yeah. So there's a sense of continuity there. So there I was in my first bit of teaching for this subject, and I was simultaneously attending the first year lessons, which were like, here is a noun. This is how we spot a noun phrase.
Great.
And also the second year lessons, which were, now do some clause analysis.
Oh, no.
It was challenging, but it was really fun. And so I did this and I thought, actually, I want to keep doing this. This is fascinating. This is just enthralling on every level, and I want to do more of it. But I did hedge my bets a bit. I applied to a degree program in English language and literature at the University of Liverpool. And basically, after the first year, I was just like, I don't want to do any more literature.
I am full on in this language thing.
Yeah, I'm committing. And how I got into corpus linguistics is that I didn't know it when I was applying, but there was this kind of little corpus linguistic powerhouse at Liverpool. So there were only kind of three or four people involved in it, but they were super, super involved. And they offered a module in the third year that was called corpus linguistics. And I noticed it had a cap on, so only about seven people could take this module. And I thought, this sounds weird. I want to do that.
I want to be one of the chosen seven.
Yeah, I want to be one of the chosen seven. And, you know, I'm going to tough out this module, because everyone was like, this is hard.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, yes, challenge accepted.
Okay.
So off I went. And then I started learning about the tools that corpus linguists use, and started building my own corpora. So I built a tiny baby corpus of music reviews. And then did a little undergraduate project on it. And I was just like, this is great. I love it. And then they offered an MA in corpus linguistics. And I was like, yes, I think I do want to take this. So did it. I think for that one, I looked at literature that was written for children and looked at gender in that. And then it came to thinking about PhDs. And I thought, well, obviously, I want to keep doing this. And also, when I was 13 or 14, we covered the suffrage movement very, very briefly in history. And I was just, there has to be more to this story. It has to be more complicated than these two pages in the textbook. So when it came to forming my own research project, it was just, right, I'm going to go back and investigate this.
And you were doing this in a corpus way. Maybe we should take a brief moment to talk about what a corpus is.
Yes.
And what people are doing with corpus linguistics. So basically you have like a collection of texts and then you're trying to look at what's in them and figure out what's going on there. Or is there a better definition?
Yeah. So basically the word corpus comes from the word for body. And we're talking about this body of text. And a corpus can be pretty much any size that you want to think of. So at the moment, I've worked with corpora that are just 100 texts.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm working with a corpus that is 1.4 billion words of text. So that's quite big.
Yeah. And often they're sort of on a particular theme.
Yeah. I mean, the main thing about a corpus is that there's got to be some kind of principles involved in why you're looking at these particular texts. So, yes, it could be a massive one of everything published in English between 1800 and 2020,
mm-hmm.
which would be a lot of things.
It would be certainly a lot of things.
Or it can be really, really focused. So it could be academic writing by students who have completed 1 year of a language course.
Gotcha.
Or it could be academic writing by final year linguistics students.
But you don't want to do sort of a pick and choose thing where it's like, okay, I'm going to have this one movie review and this one essay that I wrote when I was 16, and also some emails that I've written.
Yeah.
You know, just like the first three emails I saw.
Yeah, exactly. You don't want to have it composed of lots of little bits here and there. So there are general corpora available. So you can look at something like the British National Corpus or the Corpus of Contemporary American English. And what you'll see is that they're called general corpora, and they're meant to give you this general view of the language. And that means that someone has thought very carefully about what ought to be included in an overview of the language. So you will get things like magazine articles, newspaper articles, letters, reviews, and so on. But it's done in a very, very principled way to try and make it representative of lots of language varieties rather than just, here's an essay I wrote, and here's a film review, and here's a letter I wrote to my boss, and here's a letter I wrote to my best friend.
But you could, for example, if you had like an author who donated their archives to a museum, you could say, okay, here's a corpus of everything Virginia Woolf has donated to this archive, and that could still be a corpus.
Yeah, absolutely. You could definitely have a corpus that's based around a single author's writing. But even then, you'd probably want to make some distinctions. So when you come to store the corpus, you probably do want to break it down into what we call subcorpora. So these are like little bits of a corpus within a corpus. So if we wanted a corpus of Virginia Woolf's writing, we probably want her published work.
Right.
We probably want her diaries, and we probably want her letters all stored separately.
So you could compare what she's doing in different ones.
Yeah, it allows us to do just more with it. So we could compare diary entries and letters and see, does she write in a similar way when she's writing something that's purely for herself versus to other people?
Yeah, totally. Okay, so you were like, corpuses, corpora, they're the future. I'm really into them. Yeah. You're also going to do a PhD.
Yes. And one of the nice things about Liverpool is, again, didn't realise this when I applied, is that one of the programmers of one of the main tools we use was based there. So someone called Mike Scott, he developed a program called Wordsmith, and you can get it at lexically.net. And basically, he wrote this program. And it's a specialist corpus program that is designed to look at patterns in language. It means that we can analyze more text than we would ever be able to analyze manually. And we can stick it in there and we can let the computer do something it's very good at.
Which is finding things.
Yeah, which is finding things and counting things. So if, for example, we had a copy of your book, and I said, okay, now go in there and highlight and count every instance of the.
Yep.
What would you do?
Scream and cry, first of all, because this would be a lot of work and I don't think I'd want to do it. And then also I'd probably do a very bad job.
Oh, yeah, totally. Like you would miss instances and you'd lose count. You'd be like 3,026. No, was that 3,027 or 26? And it'll be just a miserable experience. It'll be awful. It would take ages and it would kind of be a waste of your time.
Yeah, and the computer can do that much better than I can. So, you know, if I have a digital copy of my book, which I do, and I can go in and use like the find feature and go, you know, control F or find the string THE and show me all of those. What's the advantage of using specialized corpora software over just, you know, control F in a text file?
So control F doesn't really show you the context. So what a corpus program will do is pull out that string of words, so let's say THE, and then it will show these instances in separate lines with some of the words around it. And that allows you to look for these bigger patterns and broader patterns across lots of language. So we know that the is a determiner, that it usually appears in front of some words.
You know, nouns and adjectives and so on, yeah.
Yeah, but when we look at a lot of it at once, we might be able to see particular patterns. So it's usually used when we're talking about something that definitely exists. So not something that exists in the abstract. So hand me the bread rather than hand me some bread.
Gotcha, gotcha. So it's a sort of a specific quantity or a specific item.
Yeah, it's a specific item. It's something that definitely exists and is kind of there with you.
And maybe something that's already been mentioned or something like that.
Yeah. Computers are super, super good at counting. They're super, super good at finding and identifying these strings. But they're not very good at the analysis bit. So we don't want our computer to do the analysis for us. And we want to be very aware of the kind of software and the kind of programming that goes into it to give us the results. Because we as humans are fantastically sensitive to language. And that's where the human element comes in. It's why we don't just leave it all to the computers to do as they will with it.
So it's really a lot more of a partnership between the, you know, computer showing you some things and the human making meaning out of that.
Yeah, exactly. It's meant to be a kind of partnership where you play to each other's strengths. You let the computer do the bit it's good at, and then you do the bit you're good at.
And the human side also comes in when you're talking about, okay, how do I decide that this particular set of texts should be the one that I make a corpus of, or that I focus on, or that I group together compared to the other set of texts?
Oh, yeah. I mean, there are so many corpora that you could build that we haven't even covered it, that someone could go out there and make a corpus and it would be something totally unique that someone hasn't really thought of before. One of the problems is if the data doesn't exist in a machine readable format, we can't do a lot with it. So something that is kind of digitally native, that is an email and it was always digital, is much easier to work with. It's much easier to obtain. However, something like newspapers, well, let's say pre 2000, pre 1995 newspapers, super hard to work with.
Because they all have to be digitized.
They all have to be digitized. They didn't exist in a digital format. So basically what you have to do is someone has got to scan each newspaper and then use something called optical character recognition to try and convert the image into text.
More or less accurately.
More or less accurately. The problem is that newspapers are ephemeral. They were never meant right. to be hoarded and collected.
And they're on this like cheap, thin paper that degrades so fast.
They're on this cheap, thin paper that is, if you touch an old newspaper, you just fear that it's going to disintegrate in your hands. Mm. And the text fades. And also the printing, particularly in the early days, wasn't super accurate. So you get all sorts of like little ink smudges and blobs. Mm. And then the OCR program has a problem. Like, is this an L or is this an I?
Right, right. And so if you're trying to search for something.
Yeah. Or if, is this an A or is this an O or is this an E with a blob on it? Or is this actually a B, a D, a P, etc., that's kind of lost the tail? And it's kind of a nightmare.
But you've done research on newspaper, you know, historical newspaper corpora anyway.
Yes, I did. So I did my PhD on the media representation of the suffrage movement. So using newspapers from the Times between 1908 and 1914. So I just kind of had to make my peace with the fact that the OCR was not going to be super, super accurate. But on the other hand, I had 7 million words of this in just my suffrage corpora. So not even the main corpus with everything it, just the stuff that I'd extracted that was somehow mentioning suffrage or suffragists or suffragettes. And so I had a lot of data there. And so that made me feel a bit more confident that if I'm seeing something, it's because it's there rather than because, you know, I want to see it.
It's still some sort of example of a general trend because you have lots of examples of it.
Yeah, exactly.
So what kinds of things did you see in the suffrage corpus?
Basically, that people were really, really concerned with suffrage direct action. So first of all, what I did was read a lot of history. And what they tended to work on is stuff produced by suffrage campaigners themselves.
Right.
And they were prolific. So you have things like records of meetings, you have meeting minutes, you have their own journals, you have lots of pamphlets. So they were writing down their ideas and producing them in pamphlets which could be disseminated. You also had diaries, letters, and other kind of stuff. So they were already working with lots and lots of data. But it was from a particular perspective. And what I wanted to find out is, how did someone who wasn't involved in the suffrage movement hear about them?
Right.
So if you're a reader of the Times, which was at the time of this time period, the paper of record, so it's what people who were influential and often very politically or economically connected read. So you're someone who has no connection with the suffrage movement. You want to find out about it. You read the Times. What kind of perception do you get from it?
Yeah, like what's the time saying? Are they presenting their demands as reasonable or not reasonable? Are they for or against it is the question that comes to mind immediately.
Yeah, so are they broadly supportive or are they broadly hostile? Mm-hmm. So one of the things I found from the historian's research is that there were lots and lots and lots of suffrage societies. So it wasn't that there was one main campaign group. There were about 50. And right. These different groups who have different aims, who want the votes for different purposes. So we see this enormous diversity. It basically covered the entire political spectrum. It covered different regions. There was a group up in the Orkney Islands and groups down in Cornwall. So pretty much the full breadth of the UK. Mm-hmm. There were groups with international focuses as well. And what the Times does is basically flatten all of this.
Ah.
So what you do there is see that the term that the campaigners who campaigned through basically trying to introduce legislation and trying to get members of parliament to support bills and did petitions and met up with members of parliament and so on. These tended to be known as suffragists.
Right.
And then those who preferred direct action, so things like throwing rocks through windows, sometimes leading huge demonstrations, sometimes doing things like setting fire to boat sheds.
Gosh, okay.
Yep, there was a whole arson campaign that doesn't really get talked about.
I wonder why.
These tended to be known as suffragettes. And what you find in the Times is that they're just all suffragists.
Oh, okay. So they're just saying, like, we're not paying attention to the fact that there are differences between these movements or that they don't all agree with each other. They don't all agree with each other's tactics. They don't all have the same goals. We're just going to lump them all together.
Yeah, basically, here's this enormous diverse movement and we're just going to smush it all into the same thing and kind of erase all of these very important differences. And then if you've smushed it all into the same thing, if one part of that group does something that you don't like, you can blame all of them for it.
Right. So the people who are setting fire to boat sheds, you can blame them for the people who are, you know, meeting with the MPs and trying to lobby sort of behind the scenes.
Exactly.
And just be like, well, they're all arsonists or whatever.
Exactly. So what I found is that there was this a lot of stuff about direct action. So lots and lots and lots of stuff about suffrage campaigners disrupting meetings, heckling mm-hmm. speakers. As I said, setting fire to boat sheds was a popular one. So what I did is I used corpus techniques here to look at what words were associated first with the suffrage terms, found that there were a load of terms associated with direct action,
mm-hmm.
and then looked at those in more detail to work out what kind of actions or what kind of activities they were describing. And it ended up being quite useful because different words were used to describe different things. So, for example, they were quite reluctant to call things suffrage violence because that kind of put a bit too much on it. But then there were things like suffrage incidents and disorder, which seemed a little bit more neutral.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Yeah. So what I found is that there were some terms that were very, very commonly used, and it was mainly because they were vague enough to kind of cover a lot of things.
I mean, I guess that's still true in the modern day. Like, if you're going to call something a riot, that's committing to something. Whereas if you say it's a march, well, is it a, you know,
yeah.
Are you taking sides for or against a march? There was just some people marching, or it was a protest. Like, there are these terms that media can use to sort of shape public perception of what's going on.
Yeah, and they can make it sound worse than it is as well. So, again, I think some of the things that I found you can see today if you look at different protest movements. So things like Black Lives Matter.
Mm-hmm.
There is this kind of spectre of the Black Lives Matter activists being created that bears very, very little resemblance to who the activists actually are.
Right. And it's also a like big, diverse group that has lots of different people's agendas and lots of different ways of, you know, trying to accomplish things.
Yeah, absolutely. It's a big, diverse movement. And again, that diversity is not necessarily recognized.
So that was your dissertation all about suffrage movements. What was the trajectory like to get from there to where you are now?
So as some people probably know, academic jobs are pretty hard to come by.
Yes, indeed.
So I spent a lot of time working in one university for a semester, another university for a year, and so on.
Mm-hmm.
So basically what I had to do was diversify my own teaching. As a PhD student or as a PhD scholar, you end up being very, very focused on your particular area of expertise.
Right.
And you pretty much end up being the world or a leading expert in it.
In this very narrow area.
Yeah, it often is a super narrow area. But unfortunately, unless you're extremely lucky, most universities don't have room in their budget to employ someone who can only teach on their super narrow area.
So you can't teach, like, you know, four different courses on, you know, corpus linguistics of the early suffrage movement.
Yeah, exactly. I couldn't teach four different courses on the corpus linguistics of even newspaper texts.
Right.
So,
right.
You know, even broadening that out a bit. So if I was lucky, I could teach a corpus linguistics module.
Right.
But even then, that would be covering areas of corpus linguistics that I don't really do a lot of.
Right. And sometimes they might also want you to say, you know, hey, could you just teach like morphology or something for us?
Yeah, which happened. So at one point it was like, hey, we've employed you to do this course on kind of stylistics, which is the study mm-hmm. of literary texts using linguistic approaches.
Right.
Can you also teach history of English? And I was like, sure, guess I can.
Okay.
So basically I ended up kind of like an hourglass, where as an undergraduate, you do a lot of different things and you gradually mm-hmm. narrow your focus until you get to the PhD. And then I had to broaden my focus again and become comfortable teaching in everything to do with language and use, I guess. So I did teach a first year grammar module, which was a bit hair-raising. It was like, oh God, I haven't done this since I was an undergraduate myself.
But you do end up with the sort of generalizable research skills where you can be like, oh,
yeah.
I can, even if I need to go spend a month brushing up on this, at least I am now good at reading academic texts.
Yeah, exactly. You end up being very good at being able to identify key texts in an area and then following the literature, basically. So following the citation trail and just going like, okay, well, they seem to be drawing on this work and that looks useful, so I'll go off and read it. Okay, so this work has been used in this way by someone else, and that seems interesting. I'll go off and read it. So you end up having the skills to teach yourself stuff. And also, it's been really good for my own research, because I think we can get a bit too narrow in scope. So suddenly teaching stuff like stylistics and kind of analysing narrative and looking at sociolinguistics and so on has been really informative for my own work. And I'm able to bring in these other things.
Yeah, that's really fun. I think I definitely went through a similar process of becoming more broad when I was, you know, leaving grad school and being like, hey, if I'm going to do general interest pop linguistics, I can be interested in any subfield of linguistics because I might need to explain it to somebody who's never heard of it.
And isn't it great?
It's so a lot much of fun. And you can draw these really fun connections.
Yeah. And also it just all feeds into what you're doing and kind of what you're about. And it makes you a better linguist if you are familiar with more of these areas.
So do you have another research project that you're working on at the moment?
Yes. Yeah, so basically, my co-investigator or partner in crime went to me and said, hey, Kat,
mm-hmm.
I've just got my hands on 1.4 billion words of online erotica.
Okay.
And they were like, do you want to have a play with this? And I was like, of course. Because how can you say no to an offer like that, right?
It's a huge corpus, and I bet it's very interesting to analyze, and probably not a lot of other people have done it.
Yeah, it's again one of these texts that people feel kind of like, ooh, well, it's not literary or it's not kind of proper in some way. So it's not kind of a formal text genre. There's something a bit kind of underworld about it. And so we were just like, yep, this sounds great.
Yeah, I know people who are analyzing fan fiction, and I guess you could sort of think of this as not that dissimilar of a genre in the sense that it's, you know, open contribution from anybody. People are doing stuff. Maybe they have the responding to comments and doing certain things, and you probably end up with certain tropes.
Yeah, it's been really interesting going to conferences because other people are doing kind of normal, sensible things like looking at academic writing or looking at novels or looking at, you know, general speech. And there we are going like, yep, erotica. But it's also really interesting to use it as a lens of what do these texts say about human interactions?
So what have you found about human interactions?
So I've been doing some work on consent. Mm-hmm. Because the classics of the more sociolinguistic orientated work, and this is where teaching in that area has been super helpful, mm-hmm. is that people say no in various complicated ways.
Right. Yeah.
If we want to refuse something, it's a dispreferred response. So that means that it's not the response that the person who's asking necessarily wants. And that means we usually have to be more elaborate about it.
So if I say something like, hey, Kat, do you want to get coffee later?
Yeah, and I couldn't. I'd be like, I'm so sorry, I'd love to, but this other thing has come up and I really have to go to that.
Unfortunately, I'm allergic to coffee and also, you know, like my parrot needs me at home and all of these things.
Yeah, exactly. We feel that we've got to give a much fuller explanation.
Whereas if I say, do you want to get coffee? And you're like, yeah, great. What time? Then you can make this very fast, short.
Yeah, exactly.
Affirmative response, because that's the preferred response in that scenario.
Yeah. And if you said, do you want to go for a coffee? And I said, no, you'd probably feel pretty bad about that. Yeah, exactly. So these more elaborate responses are a way of smoothing over a social interaction, mm-hmm. and about making our listener feel, okay, no, this person does still like you. They just can't go right now.
It's not that they don't want to, it's just that they can't. But then even if you don't want to, you sometimes feel this need to provide a reason why you can't. Because, like, if someone invites me for dinner and I really don't like them, I might be like, oh, no, I can't. I've got something else going on that night. Even if the other thing I have going on is, like, staying home and reading my book.
Yeah, exactly.
Because I don't want them to think I hate them.
Exactly. And that's something that we find in discussions of sexual consent, that people mm-hmm. are very reluctant to give a no where it's, I don't want to, because that risks either hurting someone that we care about, or potentially, if we're in a not so good situation, exposes us to violence.
Right.
So generally, we see these no's as being quite elaborate and often about I can't do something rather than I don't want to do something.
Like, no, I can't come up to your apartment for coffee because I've got to go home. You know, my parent will be expecting me, sort of thing.
Or even I don't want to have sex. I've got a headache. I'm feeling really gruff. I just don't feel up for it.
Right.
It's a I can't rather than I don't want to. So one of the things that we've seen is stuff to do with use of condoms. Mm-hmm. So in particular, if someone says, I don't have a condom, what are they doing with that?
Mm. So that could be a way of saying, you know, it's not that I don't want to, it's just that I can't.
Exactly. So basically, if someone's saying, I don't have a condom, that could be a whoops, love to, just can't. It's just not physically possible for me to do this. So we'd expect that to be one of these soft no's.
Mm-hmm.
But are people interpreting that as a no?
Right. Or are they interpreting that as, oh, it's okay, I'll just go down to the corner store and buy one and then we can proceed.
Yeah. So one of the things I was interested in is the previous academic work on it, which just suggests that people do say no and mean it by saying, I don't have a condom. And that's just, mm-hmm. I don't want you to go and find one. I don't want you to pop to the corner shop and buy a pack.
Mm-hmm.
I'm trying to say no in a way that isn't going to hurt you or offend you.
Right, right. The same sort of, you know, oh, I can't go for a walk. I don't have a jacket. I don't have the right shoes. It's sort of, I lack the necessary equipment for this activity.
Or indeed, you know, oh, I can't. I've not had enough caffeine today.
Yeah.
It's a problem I could fix.
Yeah, you could just have another coffee.
I don't want to fix it, though.
Yeah.
So we're interested in these texts. So what happens when someone says, I don't have a condom? And what happens after that? So what kind of actions does it lead to?
Right.
So basically, this is where I used my corpus program to look for every instance of the word condom in a set of these texts.
Right. Okay.
Computer was really good at this. You know, gold star computer. It was great. And then I had to read them.
Of course.
And I had to kind of work through a decision tree of possible outcomes and see basically what happened. Do you want to guess what happens?
Well, you know, I think there might be a bit of a confound from the fact that this is something that's marketed or supposed to be online erotica. So you know, if the scene just ends as you would hope that it might end in real life by saying, oh, well, you know, okay, maybe next time, you know, have a nice night. Mm-hmm. The person who's reading this in the particular genre is like, you know, if it's like if you're reading a mystery novel and you don't find out who did it, you're disappointed.
Lovely analysis of genre there. Yeah, basically what happened is that someone would say, I don't have a condom. And then the other person would fix that problem in some way. So either,
right,
that's fine, I've got some.
Mm-hmm.
Or, don't worry, we can borrow my ex-boyfriend's or my mum's or my sister's.
I see.
Or, don't worry, I'm an elf under the age of 99, and therefore it's okay, can't get pregnant.
Love a fantasy scenario, yep.
Yeah, honestly, that one was one of my favourites. I think I saved that story just to be like, they have thought about it, and I appreciate that.
Here are some magical elves that don't get STIs. Great, great.
Yeah, awesome. And, of course, the biggest category was, oh, that's fine, I'm on birth control.
Mm-hmm.
Or, that's fine, let's just do it anyway.
Right, because again, we have confounds of the genre.
Yeah, we have expectations here. And also there's something going on there about it's a bit, it's not quite allowed. There's something a little bit naughty, a little bit, you know, kind of...
taboo about...
Yeah, yeah, risky about that. There's something, yeah, something a bit taboo about that. So basically what we found is that what the sociolinguistics were saying about no's didn't quite apply to what was happening in these texts.
Interesting.
Yeah, it leads us to a really interesting question about how do people read these texts?
Right, and is this sort of, you know, acting out a fantasy that you wouldn't do in real life, which is, okay, it would be risky to not have a condom with and a random stranger that you just met or something like that, but, you know, if it's just written as words on a screen, then that's a way of thinking about that that's not actually real. Or is this somewhere where people are actually getting the idea that it would be fine to do this in real life?
Exactly. So does it exist in the world of the text where perhaps some of these rules and boundaries and things don't exist in the same way? So you can have unprotected sex without any consequences. And that's just how it works in this imaginative world.
Mm-hmm.
And that's fine. But the problem is, are people reading these as reflections on real life? And are they getting their knowledge from this?
Right. And so, I mean, this sounds like a good question for like sex educators.
Exactly. And that's the next step of our research project, that we want to start talking to sex educators and writers of similar texts.
Mm-hmm.
And just kind of work out what's happening when you write these texts, what's happening when you read these texts. One of the things is that we don't necessarily expect the writers to have actually experienced the scenarios that they write about.
I mean, I think that the 99-year-old elf is probably unlikely, yes.
I don't know. I mean, who knows? You know, it's a big, wide world out there.
I haven't met all of the people in the world. Maybe some of them are elves.
Yeah, I mean, I am an empiricist. So yeah, it's like, when you write these, are you writing about things you've actually done? Are you writing about things that you'd like to do but haven't had the opportunity to do so?
Right.
Or are you writing about things that you find erotic, but if someone said, I can make that fantasy come true today, you'd be like, oh no, I don't actually want to do this.
Right. Because people do read about a lot of things that are fantastic. I mean, you can read about elves in a non-erotica context as well. You can read about murder mysteries and not want to be committing murder. Like, there's lots of things that people do read about that are very much in the realm of the fantastic.
Yeah, and there's a whole category on this in our text that is just about fantasy. There's another section that is about horror. Mm-hmm. People have fantasies about aliens and about werewolves and all sorts of things that if these were actually capable of being carried out, I think we would have heard something about the sheer number of aliens and vampires and werewolves roaming the world.
Right. And yet you can see if you're reading about aliens and vampires and werewolves and other genres and they do the sort of polite fade to black, you might think, you know what? What if that scene was written about?
Yeah, exactly. So there's something about people just having permission to imagine things and sometimes having permission to imagine things that they can't carry out.
Yeah. So we'll link to some of your papers that you've written about various aspects of corpus linguistics and things like that. Is there anything else you'd like to point people to when it comes to work that you're interested in?
Yeah, so there's a number of people who are doing work on particularly queer linguistics that is really, really interesting. So one of the things that my co-investigator Alon and I have found really useful is looking at people who are looking at sex advice, because it's kind of the other side of the coin to what we're doing. So we're looking at how people articulate sexual identities and experiences and desires. Mm-hmm. And then sex advice columns do something different. And they're kind of like, what do you want to do? And this is how you can go about it. So I particularly like Amy Bailey's work on homonormativity in queer women's media, because she started out looking at sex advice columns for queer, bi and lesbian women's websites.
Right.
And then was increasingly interested in, okay, so what are they doing about, say, bi women who may have sexual experiences and desires and so on with people of different genders? And how do we make room for these desires and experiences and so on in a community focused on women who have sex with women?
The word homonormativity suggests that maybe they're not making a lot of space for this.
Yeah, so it's kind of, how do we establish this homonormativity, which is not just about sexual behaviours, but also kind of cultural identities as well. So how do we have this unified kind of queer women identity that isn't too troubled by the existence of bisexual women?
Right, that sounds neat.
Yeah, it's really cool stuff. So Amy is a relatively new PhD graduate, and I'm just so interested in what she does next.
Awesome. We'll link to that as well. And finally, if you could leave people knowing one thing about linguistics, what would it be?
So I think you can tell from what I've been saying that I am basically all over the place in terms of research interests and experiences and so on. And I think that that's the great joy of linguistics, that it lets you explore absolutely anything you want, from anthropology to neuroscience. If you want to get into ethnography, there's so much linguistic work making use of that. If you want to look at how people's language goes wrong or how people acquire language, you can get into some really, really scientific areas where you are doing things like MRI scans and things. There are just so many applications for it, and it has applications for everything involving human knowledge that somehow involves communication. And I think that's just so exciting and so kind of magical about linguistics.
For more Lingthusiasm and links to all the things mentioned in this episode, go to lingthusiasm.com. You can listen to us on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, SoundCloud, YouTube, or wherever else you get your podcasts. And you can follow at Lingthusiasm on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and Tumblr. You can get IPA scarves, Kiki Booba notebooks, and other Lingthusiasm merch at lingthusiasm.com/merch. I can be found as at Gretchen A. McSee on Twitter, my blog is allthingslinguistic.com, and my book about internet language is called Because Internet. Lauren tweets and blogs as Superlingo, and Kat Gupta's website is mixosaurus.co.uk, and they tweet at mixosaurus. Have you listened to all the Lingthusiasm episodes and you wish there were more? You can get access to 56 bonus episodes to listen to right now at patreon.com/lingthusiasm or follow the links from our website. Patrons also get access to our Discord chat room to talk with other linguistics fans and other rewards, including a special sticker pack in the mail if you join before November 3rd, 2021. Recent bonus topics include linguistic illusions, translation in linguistic fiction, and an interview with Emily Graff from the Planet Word Language Museum. Can't afford to pledge? That's okay too. We also really appreciate if you can recommend Lingthusiasm to anyone who needs a little more linguistics in their life, especially for our anniversary month. Lingthusiasm is created and produced by Gretchen McCulloch and Lauren Gaughan. Our senior producer is Claire Gaughan, our editorial producer is Sarah Dopirella, our production manager is Liz McCullough, and our music is Ancient City by The Triangles.
Stay Lingthusiastic!